Hi, and welcome to Storytime Online for Hillsborough County Public Schools. My name is Lakema Massey Barron, and I am an author of teen books. I'm excited to be here and read this book with you. Let's get started. The title of our story today is When Wilma Rudolph Played Basketball. When Wilma Rudolph Played Basketball by Mark Weakland and illustrated by Danielle Duncan. During the 1960 Olympic Games in Rome, a young woman took her place next to the other runners at the starting line. The gun fired with a pop. Wilma Rudolph, a runner from the United States, surged forward. She was all power and fluid motion. 11 seconds later, Wilma crossed the finish line first. She had won the gold medal in the women's 100 meter dash. It was the moment Wilma had imagined. She was no longer the sickest girl in Clarksville, Tennessee. She was the fastest woman in the world. When Wilma Rudolph was born, June 23, 1940, she was the 20th child in a family of 22 children. Because she was born almost 2 months early, Wilma was a tiny baby. She weighed just a little more than 4 pounds. Wilma's parents didn't know then that Wilma would one day become famous. Wilma was an energetic baby. Her early birth caused health problems. Wilma became sickly after her first year. By the time she was 4 years old, she had suffered through chicken pox, pneumonia, whooping cough, and scarlet fever. In the 1940s, racial discrimination made it hard for Black people to get good medical care. So Wilma's mother cared for her at home. She piled on blankets and made hot drinks to help cure Wilma's illnesses. Wilma complained about her mother's remedies. "All those blankets make me sweat," she said, "and your medicine tastes awful." Wilma eventually recovered from her illnesses. But something else was wrong. Wilma's mother took her to the doctor. After finishing his examination, the doctor spoke to Wilma's mother. "I'm sorry, Blanche," he said. "Your daughter has polio." The polio left Wilma's leg crooked and her foot turned inward. The doctor told them Wilma needed a leg brace. "The doctor says you won't walk without that brace, Wilma," said her mother, "but I know you will." "I believe you, Mama," said Wilma. Twice a week, Wilma and her mother took a bus to a medical college 50 miles away. There, Wilma received physical therapy for her leg. Spending so much time trying to get well was tough on Wilma. She couldn't play with the other children. By the time she was 7 years old, Wilma was fed up. But she was also determined. No more taking what comes. Enough is enough. Wilma imagined herself walking and running without her brace. Most importantly, Wilma followed her imagination with action. She did exercises. She took off her brace and she practiced walking without it. "I'm going to be healthy just like the rest of them," she said to herself. Soon, Wilma could walk well enough to go to school. "Finally," she said, "a place I can be with other kids." As she grew older, Wilma realized how difficult life was for most African Americans. She saw racial discrimination everywhere. Segregation meant that Black people couldn't do the same things as white people. They had to use separate drinking fountains and bathrooms. They even had to sit at the backs of buses. Wilma also noticed how hard her own mother worked as a maid and cook. "There's something not right about all of this," Wilma thought. "White folks got all the luxury and we Black folks got the dirty work." Wilma became determined to do something other than serve white people. At age 9, Wilma took a huge step forward. One Sunday, Wilma's parents held open the church door for her, as they always had. "Hold on," Wilma said. "There's something I have to do." Wilma took off her brace outside, then she propped her crutches against the wall, opened the door, and walked inside. Wilma limped down the aisle. People watched as she walked by. One woman even yelled out. Wilma beamed and kept on walking. By the time she was 12 years old, Wilma's brace was off for good. For years, she had watched other children play on the playground. She had studied girls playing basketball and memorized their moves. Now she was determined to be on the basketball team. She thought to herself, "Wilma, tomorrow you're going to see what it feels like to play a little basketball." Wilma signed up for the basketball team, but for the first few years, she didn't get much playing time. Coach Cece Gray only put her in at the end of a game, when her team was sure to win or sure to lose. But Wilma was determined. She practiced hard, sometimes for hours a day. Coach Gray jokingly called her Skeeter. "You're little, you're fast, and you always get in the way," he said. Before her fourth season, Wilma continued buzzing like a Skeeter. "Coach Gray," she said, "if you put as much time on me as you do on some of the other girls, I'd be a star player on this team." Her persistence paid off. Right before the first game that year, Coach Gray put Wilma in as a guard. Burt High School, Wilma's team, hosted a tournament that season. During one game, Wilma scored 32 points, and Burt High had a new star, Wilma Rudolph. Wilma was a star basketball player, but her best talent was running. "I love the feeling of freedom in running," she said. When Ed Temple, the track coach at Tennessee State University, saw Wilma playing basketball, he was impressed. She was a small teenager, but she had amazing speed and focus. Coach Temple invited Wilma to join his sports training camp. There, she trained with the university's women's track club, the Tiger Bells. The Tiger Bells were already famous for winning Olympic medals in 1952. Wilma would add to their fame. While in high school, she ran with them in the 1956 Olympic Games. The USA's four-woman relay team was made up of Wilma and three other Tiger Bells. Together, the women earned a bronze medal in the relay race. Now that she had a taste of victory, Wilma was determined to do better. She wanted to be standing on the gold medal platform at the next Olympic Games. 4 years later, she achieved that goal. The end. Thank you for spending time reading with us for Storytime Online. Remember to keep reading every day.
Hi, my name is Dr. Stacy Hahn. Your Hillsborough County School Board understands the importance of literacy. We know being able to read, write, speak, and listen are important to being a successful student and grown-up. I hope you enjoyed this Storytime Online book. You can find this book, published by Capstone, on myon.com, in your media center, public library, or available for purchase at Barnes & Noble, Amazon, or your favorite bookstore. We'd like to thank our Read On, MyOn partners for making this Storytime Online possible.